How are Indian companies doing on globalization? I think the short answer is extraordinarily well, if you just look at the numbers, right? In the last 7 years, the proportion of revenues that the top 100 companies have had from overseas assets has doubled. So more than 30% of the revenues of the top 100 companies are already from their overseas assets. That's the numbers. The question really is the health of those businesses. And I think that's a much more mixed story. So I think the story is a very good start. Certainly we've made progress in terms of acquisitions, in terms of increasing our revenues from overseas, but there's still a long way to go in terms of capturing value from the assets that we bought.
India, as you know, is a story of private entrepreneurship. I think we've had a very large number of very competitive, world-class Indian companies that are, if not world-class, highly competitive and highly entrepreneurial. Because many of these are founded, they're still being run in many cases by founder entrepreneurs, and I think they have a level of energy, edge, and competitiveness that these entrepreneurs would not be satisfied to limit only to the Indian market. I think the Indian companies have a tremendous opportunity to replicate to their success in India in other emerging markets. And it's not quite the same, but at least you have some understanding of, or at least some degree of familiarity with competing in those emerging markets.
I think companies from India that have done very well globally have done so in areas where they've been able to use technology to deliver superior services and take advantage of India's talent pool to deliver those services at an extraordinarily competitive cost, which is what really we've seen in the combination of R&D and delivery with the generic pharma companies, as well as with the IT services industry, and increasingly in other parts, for example, in components, auto components, being a good example of that. I think those are the places where we've done particularly well. You know, just because we have a low-cost, innovative model in India doesn't mean you replicate it overseas. It means you take the strengths of it, you understand what it takes to adapt it, but we've often fallen into the trap of thinking because we're successful in India, we can be successful overseas, as opposed to saying, what of what I do in India can I take overseas and adapt it to work in the context of that market?
I have no doubt, for example, that India will produce probably the most valuable generics pharmaceutical company. It will probably have several companies in the IT services landscape globally, right? Many of them already are valued higher than some of the global players. I think there's no reason why we could not have a global, for example, truck and truck manufacturer coming out of India. There's no reason why we could not have some global banks, you know, coming out of this market, international ambition. So my one aspiration would be to see some real globally recognized names from India in many, many sectors, much more than just IT and pharma.
What will it take to happen? We think there are really four things that really need to change. First is much deeper insight into what will work in that local market. Don't replicate India. Adapt India to work in that market. Second, build robust processes. Don't rely on intuition and relationships alone. Right? Risk being a good example of that. These are unfamiliar risks, new markets, new territories. It's easy to get blindsided, but very easy as well to build the sort of robust processes that have really been at the heart of the success of the great global companies like GE, like Citi, and others like that. The third point is to be an active owner, right? Too often we think, let me buy an asset, wait for it to come to fruition. That doesn't work. You actually need to create value. Many times you're buying distressed assets. This doesn't mean slash and burn. This means bring in three or four people, charge up the revenues, and make the first 6 months count to create the value. And we found there's a massive difference between those who take that active approach versus those who sit back and wait. And the fourth and most important point in my mind is you need to build a cadre of at least 50 to 100 managers who are really going to be able to carry your culture and drive globalization at the same time. When you look back at the history of the great global companies, they've often had 200, 400, 500 people who are international officers whose whole career was built on being successful in globalization. In India, when you ask someone who's responsible for globalization, It's often the same person who's the most important person on domestic issues. It's the same 5 or 10 people who are responsible for everything. That's not going to work.